Hey gamers, today we're going to look at the board game Bootleggers and the expansion, The Boardwalk. Let's check it out. To set up the game, each player will pick a family steel to be. You can play up to six players in this game, and so there's different steels here, different colors that go with it, tons of bags of, they call these influence markers, but I'm just going to refer to them as gangsters because that's what they are. So you'd have all your gangsters in a pool right here. One would always go in the back room at the beginning of each round, and that's what they look like there. That's a gangster, but they refer to them as influence markers in the game, which is kind of confusing at first. Each player will also start with a small truck. Now, there's no difference in the trucks. There are three types, small, medium, and large. And the only way you can tell the difference between them is the number. There's four. Whoops, I have these upside down. There's a four, a six, and a nine. So you have to make sure to look at it like that. And by the way, that's terrible for a large truck. They should make this 10 or 8 or something to differentiate it from the six. I hate that. But anyway, as you see, there's no difference in the vehicles. They all look the same, same color, but you just have to look at the number, small, medium, and large. So you start with a small truck. You also start with one die in your steel, and of course you can get improvements to get more. There also is a copper figure. It's a copper. And don't put this in the blue bag. The person who sold this to me put it in the blue bag, and I thought I was missing it for the longest, but that's the copper figure there, and he's going to come into play later on in the game. Now, you're also going to shuffle a bunch of muscle cards. There are four different colors of muscle cards, and you're going to deal out from those four separate piles three of each card to each player. Now, this will determine turn order. As you see, there are numbers at the top of these cards that none of them ever match, and that will determine the player order for each round. So each player secretly has some muscle cards. You have your men of action cards and truck deck over there shuffled, and the game is very simple. In fact, the instructions are right here on the board. I don't know what they use for a round tracker, so I use one of these little markers, influence markers. I'll get to what these mean in a minute, but I also use this as a round tracker for the game, and the game will go over 12 rounds. So what you're doing in those rounds, I also should mention that you are all starting with $10,000 in paper money. I almost forgot to mention that. So you have one $5,000 bill and five ones. The game also comes with $10,000 as well, dollar bills. So everyone starts with $10,000, and then you're going to deal out as many men of action cards as there are players in the game. And so in a four-player game, you would deal out four. And of course, in a six-player game, you deal out spots all the way here. Now, you would also deal out always one truck card every round. Now, the truck card may or may not be taken. If it doesn't get taken this round, it stays. But any men of action cards that did not get taken that round, they are removed from the game. So how it's going to work? The first thing you're going to do is you're going to determine what order you want to go in. So you look through your muscle cards. Now, some of these are low cost. Some of them cost nothing to play. Some of them cost $4,000 to play. And that's if you really want to go first. These are the higher number cards here. So anyway, players would just pick from their hand and then pay the amounts once they all reveal. They'll just put it down and then flip it over. And of course, you'll be going in that numbered order, whatever it is, and then paying the cost unless there's no cost, because the super low cards will have no cost attached to them. And then in player order, and this is basically kind of like bidding, you're going to choose one of these either men of action cards or a truck card. And a truck could be a small, large, or medium truck. So what you do is you take the card. Now the cards are easy. The rule book tells you what each one means, but you don't even need the rule book for them because some of them are very, very easy to understand. Some of them say, hey, do not discard until an investigation is put on this card. That's another card in the game. Some say, hey, it may be saved for later. And others, even though I don't have one, say, hey, play it immediately. All right, so you'll be looking through these, reading them off, seeing which ones you really want. Maybe there's one you really want, and so you want to pay a little bit more than other people to make sure that you get to pick first. Anyway, after everyone's picked, like I said, any remaining men of action cards, let's say these three were chosen, any remaining men of action action cards would be removed from the game, or if no one picked a truck, that truck would just stay until the next round. So after everyone has chosen a men of action card, then they're going to do some upkeep, basically. They're going to pay $1,000 for any small or medium trucks they have in their possession, and $2,000 for any large trucks they have in their possession. After that's done, it's time to place your influence markers, or your gangsters. Now, every turn, everyone starts off with one in their back room. Now, you can accumulate these, maybe through cards that are in the Men of Action deck, or just maybe not placing this round. So the next round you'll have two. Next round you'll have three. Maybe that round, then you'll put out all three at once. You can put as many as you have in your back room. But everyone's going to take turns, starting with the first player, and they're going to play on any one of these buildings here. And if you see, they have little shaded areas and unshaded areas. Now, the shaded areas, and of course O'Malley's has nothing because they're always open for business. Those are some thirsty people there. But anyway, a lot of the other places have these shaded and non-shaded areas. What that means is, once all the shaded areas in any of those buildings are full, not the light areas, but the shaded ones, then that store is also open for business. And it'll tell you, hey, how much each one pays off. The star says, hey, this one pays 2 G's. Most of them pay 2 G's except for the one on the end. It will pay 3 G's. And I'll explain more about what these other two things here mean. But anyway, you would just place your people around here, and if any of the shaded areas have been filled up by all the players, then that place becomes open. And usually it goes from left to right, since the smaller buildings have less influence markers needed to open up. Now, once that's all determined, then you're going to roll the dice for any of these businesses that are open. So, for instance, let's say that these two were open. I'd roll one die, and as you see, the spot there, too, actually tells you. So, one die for that. Oh, they're only buying one whiskey crate. And this other place, Mother's, is buying up to 9. Now, after you've determined that, then you're going to go down to your own individual player board, and then you're going to roll any dice that you have here. You start with 1, but eventually you can get cards that will give you improvements into your steel, and you can add more dice to it. And so you will roll this die here, and that's how many whiskey crates you got. So you'll take these little brown cubes, which are whiskey crates, and put them in your back room, or most likely put them in your truck. Now, even though some trucks can hold 9, obviously that cannot hold 9 cubes. You can put 9 cubes on it. So anyway, as many trucks as you have cubes. Now, if I were to roll, let's say I rolled a roll of 6, I'd have made 2 extra cubes. They would go in my back room. Now, anything unsold in my back room gets discarded at the end of every round, unless I have a special card that says otherwise. There are special cards in the deck that let you keep whiskey for another round, or maybe even sell it from your back room. Also, I should also mention there are also cards in the game that say, hey, grab an influence marker and place it on one of the areas. So basically, these influence markers, the same whiskey bottle here, you would just play, as you see, this place, Texas Lil's, can only have one improvement. This place can have 2, 3, 4. That's where the spaces are for improvements. Improvements would add 1+ to the die. So instead of selling 1 whiskey, now this place is always selling 1+1. So it'd be 2 whiskeys that are actually selling. Now, this spot, everyone is, at this junction now, everyone knows how much whiskey they have. They're loading up there in their trucks. Also, maybe if I had too much whiskey, you can also wheel and deal with other players and to ask for maybe one of their trucks. Hey, can I borrow one of your trucks this round? And basically, the rules say, hey, you can make any kind of deal you want. Hey, I'll give you $2,000 to rent out that truck. $2,000? No way, because when you sell this whiskey, you'll be making 10. Give me 4. You know, so you make deals between players to borrow other trucks. Now, at that point, you're going to be parking up into one of these 3 parking spaces. Except for O'Malley's, it's an empty parking lot. Any and as many trucks can come here and sell as much whiskey as they want to O'Malley's. But unfortunately, it's only cost you $1,000 per crate. That's the lowest paying one, where the rest of them at least are 2 or higher. And so what determines whether you park in one of these 3, 2, or 1 star determines how much influence you have out on the board. So for instance, if I have more influence markers, so I would have controlling interest right here. And if that was the case, then I would actually get $1,000 for any whiskey sold. And because I have controlling, my trucks get to park in the 3-star area, which means they buy whiskey from me first. So if I was here, another player's here, and let's say they sold, 5 whiskey, 4+1. Well, they buy my 4 first, and then they'd only buy one of that other player's here who had to park in one of these 2 spots. Now, by the way, the other 2 spots actually mean if you have a majority interest. Maybe you don't have as many as another player. Okay, so let's use this example here. In this example, Orange has a majority interest, which means they get to park in the two-star area. And by the way, it also the game also says grab these gangsters from your player pool and just put them temporarily on your trucks. Even if you're borrowing a truck from another person, you put your player on it, color there on it, to determine whose truck is whose. Basically, since all the trucks look the same, you have to put that in there. And then these would go straight back to the pool. But anyway, in this case, I have majority interest. They're going to buy my whiskey first before anyone who lines up in the one star. One star means they have a minority interest, which purple does. Or if green player was wanting to sell, let's say green player has some whiskey too, they have no interest. Anyone who has controlling or majority, they have to, the green player would have to get the yes from, you know, any of these other players, meaning, I guess in this case, Orange, to see if they could sell in that area. Now, the Orange can say, yes, you can, sure, there's plenty of money to be made, or they may say no. Now, if you have controlling interest, you may want to do that, because remember, you're making some extra money, you're getting some kickback money there. But that's what a majority interest, and a minority interest means at least you have one player pawn there, and you would park in the one star, and after everyone else has sold their whiskey, any remaining whiskey crates will be bought from you. Now, there are cards to let you place extra influence markers here, and to knock off other players' influence markers, so you can basically shake up control of a lot of these businesses here. So that's how selling whiskey goes. Now, once everyone has done selling whiskey, you will then take the, you'll leave the influence markers right there on the buildings, but you'll take back all the little player pawns, you'll take back all the whiskey. Any whiskey left over in your trucks will return back to the players who were originally theirs. And then, of course, any whiskey in your back room, as you see here, I had two, gets discarded unless I have a special card that says differently. And then you would add another influence player to your back room and restart the round. The round tracker would move, and let me get this round tracker, would move to round two. And then you, of course, deal out more men of action cards and start all over again. Now, the only difference is these little icons here. As you see, once it gets to round four, the copper is going to appear. And the copper appears to whoever sold the most whiskey that round. And so he'll come to your area. He'll come to your steel. And if any of your dice, and let's say I had three dice here now. I had two improvements in my regular die. So when it came to make whiskey, if any of these are a five, which I rolled a five, then that means the copper shut me down. I didn't make any whiskey at my regular steel. And that's sucks. And that's what happens. It's basically a catch-up mechanism that I don't really mind, because obviously if you're selling the most moonshine, the cops are going to hamper down and kind of try to bust your steal. But if you roll a five on any of your die, you can't sell there. Now, in the game, you can also buy remote steals. Certain cards will give you remote steals. It does not apply to remote steals. So if I had rolled a five over here, I still get to sell nine whiskey barrels over in my remote steal, but anything here would be shut down by the cops. So there are ways to get around that and still sell whiskey, but again, this is very thematic, so I don't really mind this catch-up mechanism, because of course the cop's going to bounce around to whoever sold the most whiskey that round. They're going to be cracking down on you. Now, the other icon that you see on the board are these little guns. This is a catch-up mechanism as well. The person with the least amount of money will get an extra influence marker for that next round. It's only in the fourth and eighth round, so it's a little bit of a catch-up there. If you're falling a little behind, it stops the runaway leader problem by letting you have more influence to dole out for the next turn, which of course could sway the game. Influence is the game, the name of the game here. You're going to keep playing like this until one of two things happens. Either you make $100,000. If you did that, the game's over. You won. Or it goes 12 rounds, and then whoever has the most money out of those 12 rounds wins. Now, the game does come with an expansion called the Boardwalk. To be honest, it looks like a mini expansion because it comes in a big old box, and that is all you get. It has casino cards. They're red men of action cards that you'll be dealing out the moment someone opens up a casino. It has improvements as well. When you add improvements to a casino, it's just like improvements to a building. It would add a +1 to the die. And you'll place it over any of the little places. So instead of Mother's Casino, Mother's Bar or whatever, it becomes Mother's Casino. It becomes a casino now because you own it. And you'd put your one influence marker right here showing this is yours. Now, to buy any of these would cost you the amount that it has here on the edge here. So you see 20, 30, 40, 50,000. And plus you have to play a certain influence marker, 3 G's. Now, when you do though, you are making big bank. And what happens, the game kind of radically changes for you. You are done selling whiskey at your steel. You dump your trucks. You're done selling whiskey at all. Even your remote steels are not selling whiskey. Now you are in an honest run business by, you know, collecting casinos. So as you are buying out these casinos here, you have to pay upkeep. You can't pay upkeep on your trucks anymore because you don't have any more, but you would pay actually 1 G for every on the die there, and then you would pay 2 G's for any entertainment acts. Those are improvements, entertainment acts. And of course, again, those are those little curtains, things there. So you'd have to pay for that as well. So that's your upkeep that you would pay, your graft in phase one. And then later on it says you come back in phase five. When anyone's selling, of course you can roll, it'll tell you how many dice you would roll to how much liquor you're consuming. And this one's paying out premium rates. 3 G's, 3 G's, 3 G's. This one's paying out 5 G's. So you're actually the biggest, you're one of the biggest contractors out there. If they want to sell their whiskey, they want to sell it at this casino because they're making tons of money. However, you are also making matching prices for everything they make, you make as well. Plus, you get a consumption roll. Crates sold, how many crates were sold times 1 G to casino owner. So man, you're making basically 4 G's in a way for each 3 G's that someone else is making. You're making tons of money here. So it costs a lot to run a casino, but it can bring a lot of money in. And of course, the game winning conditions also apply. And that's the expansion. Final thoughts, what do I think about the game? Well, I saw Bootleggers a couple of years ago and I thought, oh, that looks interesting. And then I totally forgot about it. Well, then I found it for like super cheap. You can get this game for super cheap, $5 even, $5 to $10, which is definitely worth $5 to $10. Now, the theme's kind of easy. It's like a simpler version of, Empire's Age of Discovery. It's like a simpler version, just kind of area control. You're trying to get a lot of money. It's quite simple and it is fun. Very thematic too. I mean, you're making those deals for those trucks. You're like, you're killing me. Come on, give it to me for four. No way, you're making 16 off this. I want at least 10. You know, like 10, that's, you get out of here. You're dreaming. It's great. It's so great. The copper coming is thematic. I know it's a catch-up mechanism, but it makes sense. If you're selling the most whiskey, of course they're going to come and investigate. And maybe you don't roll fives. That's happened to me a couple of times. Like, yes, I got away from the cops. But he stays there until someone else sells more whiskey than you. Such a lot of fun and well worth your time, I think, especially for the money. Now, the exact opposite for the Boardwalk. This game is a little bit more, it's more expensive than you getting the base set. Kind of weird, right? It's not worth it. It's not worth it. There could be some strategy on why you'd go legit and try to get a casino, but to be honest, who's going to go to your casino knowing it's going to benefit you more? One of these casinos costs $50,000. That's half of the winnings, you know, that you need $100,000. You really want to give up half the points it takes to win when you're halfway there just to get a casino going? So I don't really understand the Boardwalk or the strategies involved. In fact, I paid way more for this than I did for the base game, but it comes in such a huge box and like there's like a little stack of stuff in it. So yeah, this one is definitely a pass. We'll play with it, but so far no one has any reason to buy a casino. Now I could be missing on some strategy there. I don't know. I just know this one, they kind of missed the mark on this. But the base game is actually pretty good. All right, gamers, that's all the time I have for now. Until next time, game on.